What's going on, guys? Welcome back to the channel for part two of this alternative timeline, in which we try to answer the question, what would have happened if Qui-Gon survived the Phantom Menace, but Anakin Skywalker still turns to the dark side? Now, as always, I will have part one linked in the description for anyone who hasn't seen that video, because if you try to watch that one without seeing this one, well, you're gonna be pretty confused. But hey, maybe you're about that life. So either way, I'm happy to have you all here for this part of the story. And so now, without any more delay, let's get into it. Vader stood at the end of the boardwalk, which was suspended far above the ground. Qui-Gon walked toward him cautiously. "Hello, my friend," he said. Vader stood there, waiting. He knew there was a greater purpose here. He would allow the traitor to speak before his death. Qui-Gon took another step forward and continued. "Anakin, I failed you, and I'm terribly sorry for that. But do not allow yourself to be destroyed by my mistakes." Vader shot back quickly. "It is too late for me, old man. My fate is sealed, and for that, you will pay." Qui-Gon was defenseless against Vader as the cyborg before him reached out with the Force, crushing his windpipe. Vader paced toward his victim with no thought of igniting his lightsaber. That would be too easy, too fast. This coward would be made to suffer before death. The Jedi took everything. They lied, they manipulated a child, stripped him of all emotion, and then left him to burn. Yet from the ashes of destruction, I have risen above their failures, above your failures. I have brought peace, and now you come before me to question my work. Qui-Gon's legs buckled before the monster he had created, still choking, struggling to breathe, until finally Vader released him, but only to strengthen his grip. He raised the Jedi into the air and then threw him at the wall of the castle behind him. Qui-Gon struggled to rise, hardly able to even comprehend what was going on anymore. Vader grabbed Qui-Gon by his throat, but not with the Force this time. His hand wrapped around Jin's neck like a vice as he spoke. "This is the end for you, my master." But as Vader prepared to end the encounter, something caught his attention. A small cry from the shadows drew his focus for a second. Looking back to Qui-Gon, he could see that it meant something to the old man. Vader threw him once again, this time in the direction of the noise. He stepped into the shadows, igniting his lightsaber to investigate, quickly recovering the lifeless body of Qui-Gon Jinn once more, but this time with a little girl holding the dying man's head in her arms, crying quietly, giving her very best effort not to be heard. He hesitated. Vader himself could not understand what was happening. A victim was a victim. He had taken thousands of lives at this point in his life. Bounty hunters, Jedi, rebels, innocent villagers, men, women, children. He did not discriminate. None of that had ever mattered. It still didn't matter. But something was holding him back. There was something about this girl. Something in the way she was now looking at him. Her eyes. There was something about her that he recognized, something he almost sympathized with. She watched in fear as the tall robotic figure stood before her, breathing heavily, but not moving a muscle. He just stood there, his lightsaber still ignited, his helmet fixated squarely in her direction until suddenly he whipped his head around behind him, slowly walking deeper into the shadows, away from the girl. In a split second, Vader's focus changed completely. Emotions that he had not felt in a decade began to spark throughout his body, as the unmistakable voice that had commanded his attention called out again.
"Anakin."
He was overwhelmed, but the one feeling that stood out to the Dark Lord in this moment was fear. Underneath the protection of his suit, Vader was trembling. He was terrified to reveal what he had become to the voice he heard from the shadows. His heart skipped a beat as he rounded a corner to see the late Queen of Naboo, resting peacefully, her hands folded over her evidently pregnant stomach. She was dead, of course. Had been for 10 years, but her body had been kept intact. Vader approached the tomb of his late wife, recalling how much she had meant to him, how much she still meant to him. Darth Vader was a terrible man. He had done unspeakable things to countless innocent beings. He was fueled by anger, by hatred, and by pain. Yet through it all, not a day had passed that he hadn't thought about Padme Amidala. And now, as he stood over her lifeless body, he couldn't help but to imagine what may have been had he chosen a different path. He reflected on the day she died, on all the lives he had taken that day, and finally, on how excited he had truly been to be the father to her children, regardless of the challenges that were sure to rise. Gently, Vader placed his hand over Padme's womb, acknowledging his offspring who had never gotten to see the light of day, and finally, for the first time, apologizing to Padme and to his children. "I'm so sorry," he whispered. Keeping his hand where it was, Vader slowly raised his head as he sensed the presence of Qui-Gon Jinn hobbling into the room. "I gave you your chance to escape, old man. Why are you here?" Even beneath the mask, Qui-Gon noticed that Vader's voice was softer than it had been earlier. Hardly able to speak, he responded gently, "There's good in him." That was the last thing she said to me before she died. She was right. Vader turned slowly.
"It is too late for me."
He considered killing the Jedi Master right then and there, but this was not the place. He paced by his old master, exiting the room, prepared to leave this planet without a kill. But as he approached the boardwalk and headed for his ship, his attention was stolen once more. The girl. He had forgotten all about her. He paused, considering his options. There was something about that little girl standing behind him, watching from the shadows. Why was she here? Why was he here? What was the purpose in all of this? He turned again to face her. Qui-Gon had followed him back outside and fallen to the ground. Vader had seen men in his condition many times before. He didn't have long. But that was not his concern right now. Qui-Gon would not have spoken even if he could at this point. This was a revelation Vader needed to come to on his own. Leia watched as the tall robotic figure began to walk toward her again. Vader refused to believe what his senses were telling him. It was impossible, but somehow, it was true. His daughter had not only made it out of the womb, she was here. Standing just a short arm's length away from her now, Vader knelt down in front of the little girl who slowly reached out and gently placed her hand on his mask. He could no longer deny the presence of Anakin Skywalker. The boy he claimed to have destroyed years ago was still around, and this little girl, his daughter, without saying a single word, had not only brought him back out, but she had also turned Vader's heart. There was no pathway back to freedom anymore. He would be remembered forever as Darth Vader. To the galaxy, Anakin Skywalker was dead, and nothing he did or said was going to change that. But from this day forward, he would do whatever it took to protect her from the Empire. Sidious had to be eliminated. Vader rose to his feet, still staring down at Leia as he spoke. "I know what I must do, Master. Will you help me?" There was no response. He turned and approached the lifeless body of Qui-Gon Jinn. The Jedi Master was dead. Vader considered what he should do with the body, but the question was answered for him as Qui-Gon suddenly disappeared into thin air, leaving only his robes and his lightsaber behind. Vader did not know what to do with the child. He didn't know where to go or how to handle any of this. But one thing was certain. Darth Sidious posed a threat to his daughter, and so he had to be eliminated at all costs. After considering his options for a short time, Vader would have to face the fact that he needed the Jedi. He needed Kenobi. The problem with that reality, of course, is that he has no idea where Obi-Wan has exiled himself, nor if he is even still alive at this point. Days would pass, however, and word of Leia's abduction would spread, eventually reaching the ears of Obi-Wan, who would then commune with Yoda. The two of them would put their minds together, realizing that it was now time to come out of hiding. Yoda would quickly learn how to commune with Qui-Gon, who was now a fully fledged Force ghost. He would reveal to his friends what had transpired, explaining that Vader was no longer evil, but that his intentions and emotions were unpredictable. They needed to confront him, but they had to do so with great care and patience. The Jedi would eventually track Vader down, and after some brief negotiations, the trio would agree to hide Leia away with Luke on Tatooine, under the watchful eye of Bail Organa. But as they prepared to leave the desert planet to confront Darth Sidious, a destroyer would appear above them, and the Emperor's ship would descend on their location. He knew Vader had turned, and he knew that the Jedi were with him. He had even uncovered the truth about the offspring of Anakin Skywalker. He exited his ship behind an entire legion of stormtroopers, along with his personal royal guards and the Grand Inquisitor. Now, in this scenario, Yoda and Kenobi are not as old as they were in the original trilogy, so their skills are still similar to what they were in Episode 3, with their connection to the Force being even stronger. The three warriors would deflect blaster fire from the 100 or so stormtroopers who fired rapidly in their direction. Yoda would sprint through their ranks, cutting their legs off at the knees and whipping his lightsaber through the air from one victim to the next. Kenobi and Vader sliced through dozens of troopers in a matter of seconds. Emotions were of course running high at the moment, but Obi-Wan couldn't help but to recognize the feeling he had in his chest. It was just like old times. Qui-Gon was Anakin's master, yes, but Obi-Wan had still played a major role in his training. As the last of the troopers and the royal guards were wiped out, Sidious shot force lightning directly at Vader, aiming for the soft spots in his armor, which he had strategically placed there, in case that flicker of light inside his apprentice had ever been ignited. The Grand Inquisitor leapt into action, taking Kenobi out of the picture. As Sidious continued to ruthlessly attack Vader, Yoda force-pushed the Emperor backward and sprung in his direction. The Emperor ignited his own blades, which in this scenario he had kept around after Order 66. Palpatine's focus now shifted fully to Yoda, who commanded his full attention and all of his energy. Vader would recover, and the Inquisitor would be killed, as Vader force-choked him, allowing Kenobi to strike him down. Now it was 3-on-1. Sidious would have struggled to defeat Yoda on his own. In fact, he may have failed to do so altogether, but he was now facing impossible odds. He would quickly be overpowered and then sliced in two by Vader, who would not risk the Emperor's survival. Vader's heart had been turned now, but he was still no Jedi. Darth Sidious did not deserve the opportunity to stand trial, but he, Darth Vader, worthy of that chance or not, would now have no other choice. Willingly, he would go before the New Republic and be tried for his crimes. The courts would issue multiple life sentences, ensuring that Darth Vader would never see the light of day. Luke and Leia would be trained as Jedi by Yoda and Obi-Wan, growing up to be great Jedi Knights and re-establishing the Jedi Order. Thanks to the efforts and sacrifices of Qui-Gon Jinn, the galaxy would live in peace once again. As his children grew older, they would fight diplomatically to free their father. What would happen from there is up to you guys. I'm gonna go ahead and wrap this story up here, so let me know what you guys thought about this and what you would have liked to see happen with Darth Vader or Anakin from here. The biggest points I wanted to address in this video were how Qui-Gon's handling of failure would differ from Luke's because of their circumstances, and then how his presence may have aided in Vader's eventual return to the light. Obviously, this is just one of hundreds of different ways things could have gone, but this is one way that I think things could have gone if Qui-Gon had survived his duel with Darth Maul in Episode 1, but Anakin had still turned to the dark side. So let me know what you guys thought about this video in the comments section below. Please remember to give this video a like if you enjoyed, subscribe to the channel if you're new, and until next time, may the Force be with you always.